Namaste, Hariom. I extend a warm welcome to all the viewers on this national webinar series, Yoga Ramayana Vishwakosha History, Proving Authenticity and History of Ramayana. We are blessed to have Dr. Divya Keshan Murthy ji with us for telling us about women characters in Ramayana. Today's session, she'll be speaking about the character Mandodari.
Hariom, Namaste. In this 108 days webinar of Yoga Ramayana Vishwakosha, celebrating the glory of Ramayana, under the title Women Characters in the Ramayana, today I will be speaking on this female character, Mandodari. Women, they have taken central roles in our Hindu Dharma. It could be as the mothers, nurturers, the instigators of war, the propagators of the knowledge, and also as gossip as well. Our world started with this female Shakti, the Adi Shakti, which is one of the true form of energy, and since then the femininity has evolved. Hindus worship Shakti and idolize her presence. And one such amazing femininity group is the Panchakanya. There is a Panchakanya Stotra. It is Ahalya Draupadi Sita Tara Mandodari Tata Panchakanyaha Smare Nityam Mahapataka Nashe. So this verse gives us the understanding, daily remembering these five great maidens. The greatest sins that we would have committed in this life could be nullified, could be destroyed. They also say the association, they bring an association of how these Panchakanyas are the are representing the characters that is there in our nature, the Panchabhuta characters and their essence found in each of these five maidens. These Panchakanyas, they have been associated with the five elements, and each Kanya is born in one of these elements, and these five elements of nature form their essence of their character. Speaking about Sita, she was found by ploughing and she is connected to the earth element. Ahalya is associated with the wind element. Tara, she is associated with the space element. And Draupadi, since she emerged from the Yajna fire, she is associated with the fire element. And Mandodari, she was the frog who was found in the well, and she is connected to the water element. Speaking about this character Mandodari in Ramayana, her role is very short, but the most prominent one. In the Ramayana epic, she is described as a pious and the most righteous royal lady. She is considered as one of the five virgins for her ability to redeem and rejuvenate. Her name Mandodari, Mandavudara, means the soft bellied. Compared to the rest of the Panchakanyas, when we speak about this character Mandodari, her character is very less colorful, less eventful, and it has seldom prominence being given. And her image in the Ramayana, it could be possibly due to the dominant presence of Sita's character in the Ramayana, her image also lacks this substance and it fades very quickly. Now, tracing her birth history, she is believed to be the daughter of this celestial Maya and the divine Apsara Hema. Speaking about her father, Mayasura, he was an ancient king of the Asuras. He was the son of the sage Kashyapa. He was the chief architect and he designed and built great cities of prosperity and power. At a later age, on the behest of Lord Krishna and Arjuna, who saved him from the Kandava forest incident, he constructed the most famous palace hall with beautiful reflective flowers for King Yudhishthira at Indraprastha. and this palace hall was known as Maya Sabha. And speaking about Mandodari's mother Hema, she was an apsara in the Indra's court. It so happened when Mayasura visited Swarga, he happened to meet Hema. The moment he looked at her, he fell in love with her. So all the heaven people got get them married. After getting married to Hema, Mayasura brings her to the southern valley of Hemavan, and there he starts living with her, constructing a city called Hemapura. They have two sons. With Hema, the couple get two sons, Mayavi and Dunduvi. But these couple wanted a daughter. They longed to have a female child. For that desire, Mayasura and his wife started doing their prayers to Lord Shiva. So the Lord Shiva blessed him and granted them the boon that soon a daughter will be born to her, born to them, and her name will be Mandodari. Unfortunately, when she was born, Apsara, Hema, her mother, returns back to heaven, deserting her and her father. But in the absence of the mother, her Mandodari's father takes care of her very nicely. With lot of great care, with showering lot of love and attention towards her. But this is one version of speaking about the birth history of Mandodari. There are a lot of versions of Mandodari's birth. Among that, it is believed that she, in her previous form, was cursed by Ma Parvati. There was one Mandodari in a previous birth. It is believed she was again an apsara and her name was Madhura. This Madhura had performed this Somavara Vrata and she came to pay her respects to Kailash, to Lord Shiva. But it so happened when she came to Kailash, Ma Parvati was not there. In the absence of Parvati and looking at Shiva, she gets attracted to Shiva and there is a sexual union that happens. And this is got to know by Goddess Parvati. She's very furious about it and she curses this Apsara Madhura to become a frog and be in a well for about 12 years. So once this way this Madhura is being cursed, Lord Shiva consoles her and states her, assures her that after she completes the curse period, that is about 12 years, she will once again become a beautiful woman who will marry a mighty man. This is how Mayasura meets Mandodari when she starts shouting from the well after the 12-year completion of her curse. In some other versions also, like Ananda Ramayana, it is said that Vishnu created her from the sandalwood paste smeared on his body in order to delude Ravana into believing that she is Parvati, whom he has asked from Shiva. According to Ranganatha Ramayana, it is Parvati who makes the doll and Lord Shiva is the one who breathes the life into that doll. Now this doll turns out to be the most beautiful lady, which becomes a concern for Ma Parvati. So Shiva turns Mandodari into a frog. And when Maya begs for children, Shiva restores the frog to the human form and gives her to Danava as his daughter. Like the Ahalya, Tara, Draupadi, these Panchakanya, when Mandodari is compared to the other Panchakanyas, it is also found that Mandodari is also Ayonija Sambhava. Ayonija Sambhava is that one who is not born of a female. Being an Apsara with her genes, like her mother is an Apsara, in her previous form she was an Apsara, it is obvious that she would turn out to a very beautiful lady. And her beauty is described in many times in the Valmiki Ramayana. In fact, it is said that she was more beautiful than Sita. It was when Hanuman ends up in the harem of King Ravana in the search of Mother Sita, who was abducted by King Ravana, he mistakes Mandodari to be the Sita because of her beauty. There is one verse in the Valmiki Ramayana which quotes about the beauty of Mandodari. The Vanara, the Hanuman, when he sees this beautiful woman of golden complexion, who is decked with pearls, who is decked with gems and ornaments, as if illuminating the excellent mansion with her splendor. What is not known to Hanuman is that she is the king's favorite and she is also the chief queen, Mandodari. He finds her at a time when this lady was worshipping goddess Parvati. And so he mistakes that this woman should be Sita. But then again a doubt comes to him that how could a woman be embellished with ornaments, beauty and charm? She cannot be Sita because he is seeing her in a rejoiced moment. And Hanuman knows the nature of Sita, so he rejects this thought that this woman cannot be Sita, who is so royally dressed. So she definitely cannot be the mother Sita. And again, to quote this, there is a verse in the Valmiki Ramayana, which is translated as, "Lovely Sita, being away from Rama, will not sleep, will not eat or drink or adorn herself. How can she approach any other man, even if he is the king of gods? Or for there is none equal to Rama even among the gods." Having thus decided, Hanuman strolled about the banquet hall. There are numerous versions of Mandodari's marriage. Speaking about marriage of Mandodari to Ravana, there are a lot of versions that speaks about it. One version says Ravana comes to the house of Mayasura and falls in love with Mandodari. Another version says that they definitely get married with the Vedic rites. But in another version it says that Maya gives her away in marriage to Ravana and he also gives Lanka as a part of the dowry. While Ravana's interest in getting married to Mandodari begins, in the Devi Bhagavata Purana it says Ravana wanted to marry Mandodari, but then suddenly Maya warns him that her horoscope indicated that the firstborn could destroy the clan and should be killed. But Ravana ignores Maya's advice. He gets married to Mandodari. And then as soon as the first child is born, Ravana buries this child in a casket in Janaka city, where it is discovered and which grew up as Sita. So this gives us a message that Sita is the biological daughter of Ravana. Mandor, a town located at 9 km north of Jodhpur, is believed to be the native place of Mandodari. In this place, Ravana is treated as son-in-law among some local Brahmins and they have a temple dedicated to him. And in Rajasthan, the Sri Alwar Teerth of Jains celebrates the power of Mandodari's chastity. In the Ramayana, Ravana is described to be the eldest son of sage Vishrava and Rakshasi Kaikeshi. Mandodari's husband Ravana is actually widely considered as a symbol of evil. But he had many other qualities which made him also good. He was a learned scholar. He was a great scholar of Veda and he was a great Brahmin too. Ravana is often depicted and portrayed as having 10 heads, where his 10 heads represents the knowledge of the 6 Shastras and the 4 Vedas. He was a great scholar besides a great devotee of Lord Shiva. Not just being a great scholar, he was also a capable ruler and a maestro of Veena and many performing arts. Ravana had 7 brothers and 2 sisters. He had a lot of infatuation. He used to get attracted to many women. He used to lust women and he married many women. But among so many women, three of his wives were considered very important. And from these three wives, apart from Mandodari, Mandodari is inclusive of these three wives, but apart from Mandodari, the second wife name is Danyamalini. The third wife name is not known. Ravana, out of these three wives, gets about total seven sons. Among them, the eldest is Meghanada. Meghanada is also called as Indrajit. He is called Indrajit because he is considered as the possessor of Indraloka, that is the heaven. And he is considered one of the greatest warriors in the Hindu text. He is the eldest child of Ravana, a powerful fighter and the one who had groundbreaking heavenly weapons like Pashupatastra, Brahmastra, Vaishnavastra. So these were the different weapons that Indrajit possessed. He also had dominated the craft of fighting under the direction of Sukracharya, who was the guru of the Daityas, that is the guru of the devils. Meghanada was slaughtered by Lakshmana as he upsets the Yajna with the assistance of Vibhishana. The second son is Atikaya. Atikaya was the child of Ravana and his significant other Danyamalini. So Atikaya was the child of Danyamalini and he was the more youthful sibling of Meghanada. Atikaya had astounding abilities in fighting and Lakshman slaughtered him. The next child was Akshaya Kumara. He is known as Akshaya in various languages. He is the youngest son of Ravana, the brother of Meghanada. In the Ramayana, when Hanuman started destroying Ashoka Vatika, after a conversation with Sita, Ravana sends Atikaya to face the Hanuman and fight a war with him. And at that time, he was just a warrior of 16 years old. And he went to stop Hanuman based on the directions given by his father. Hanuman was quite impressed with the valor of this young boy, but still he had to fight. In the end of the battle, Hanuman kills the Atikaya. The other two sons are Narantaka and Devantaka. Narantaka headed a military comprising 720 million Rakshasas. Angada, the child of Vali, some places he is also called as Bali, in the end slaughters him. And Hanuman executes Devantaka during the war. Trishira, another son of Ravana, is a talented champion. He drew Rama in the battle. But in the end, he was slaughtered by Lord Rama. Prahastha was an incredible Rakshasa warrior. He was the central officer of Ravana's military in Lanka. And Lakshmana, in the end, kills him. So that's in this way, the war led to all the sons of Ravana being killed by either Lakshmana or Rama or Hanuman. Mandodari's husband Ravana, though a learned scholar man, had one terrible weakness towards women. He kidnapped several women and forced them to be with him. So this character was definitely not appropriate and it was thoroughly disliked by his queen Mandodari. Despite Ravana's fault, Mandodari also had one weakness, that she loved her husband the most. She was very proud of his strength. She was aware of his weakness, but again, she was a helpless woman. But within her, she had this personality of being a most righteous woman. So Mandodari kept trying to plead and lead Ravana to the path of Dharma, the righteous path. But Ravana kept ignoring her advice all the time. Though Ravana is known for this weakness of women, lusting for women, deep within his heart, he loved and respected only Mandodari. And that was the speciality of Ravana. Mandodari is described as the woman of patience, bearing with the atrocities her husband commits towards other women. When Ravana abducted Mother Sita, Mandodari always tried to dissuade him. She always made him understand that what he did was wrong and Sita had to be given back to Lord Rama. After Ravana kept Sita hostile, Mandodari herself was not jealous of Mother Sita. She was a self-confident lady. It was the weakness of Ravana. There was nothing for her to add that she would compare herself and feel low about herself. No, she never did that. So there is one verse in the Valmiki Ramayana, it says, Nakulena na rupena na dakshinena maithili mayadika vatulya vatvan tu mohan buddhyasi. This verse translates as, Sita is no match for me either in birth or in beauty or in amiability. You did not perceive this through infatuation. So this is what is being quoted about Mandodari in the Valmiki Ramayana. Mandodari, like the women like Mandodari represents perhaps the kind of anger, they hide this anger and anguish in their heart and they lead a life of duality. The surface made turbulent by varied experiences and a silent core in their soul where wisdom originates. Mandodari as a lady had this inherent gift of distinguishing what is right and what is wrong. And in this situation of crisis, Mandodari knew how to insist on doing things what was correct. She was an eloquent speaker and had the influence to influence people by her power of words. When she looked at the current situation, she understood one thing. Her agony as a wife is getting doubled. It is because she felt when Ravana kidnapped Sita and endangers her position as the chief queen of Lanka. And whether he wins also, whether he loses the battle also, she is the one who is going to lose the most. So as a wife, her agony doubles when Ravana kidnaps Sita. She bears the lechery of her husband and she can foresee her misery even whether Ravana wins or loses the battle. In case of a win, Sita will become the chief queen and she the attendant. If Ravana loses, she will either become a sati with her dead husband or she has to marry the Ravana's brother, or she, it's more like she'll be offered to the Ravana's brother Bibhishana as his concubine. Mandodari was a pious woman. She had the greatest sensibilities. For that reason, she could foresee many ill omens that was coming with the abduction of Sita, and she realized that Ravana's passion would result in ruin for all. But in spite of all her efforts, she did not succeed in averting the path of doom and destruction. She advised her sons to not to fight Rama. But the problem was, though they were obedient to the mother, they were far more obedient to the father. And for the call of the duty, they did not follow her advice. It is said Ravana organized a yagna to assure his victory over the death of his sons and many brave journals. And for this, Rama sends Angada to disturb the yagna. Mandodari feels this kind of disturbances that is getting created while the yagna process is on is considered to be a bad omen, an ill omen. And she warns Ravana repeatedly to give back Sita. But then again, Ravana is Ravana. He does not heed to her advice. According to Kashmiri Ramayana, Ravana entrusts Sita to Mandodari soon after he brings her to Lanka. The moment this Mandodari sees the Sita, There is an inexplicable surge of affection towards Sita as her breast overflow with the milk. She recognizes Sita as the daughter she gave birth and bids her choose death over submission to Ravana. Mandodari always has tried to show the right path to her husband to overcome the self-esteem, to care for her subjects, and to return to Rama, return Sita to Rama with due honor. When all the attempts of peace, peaceful return of Sita to Rama fails, Rama declares war on Ravana's Lanka. And before the final battle against Rama takes place, Mandodari once again makes a last attempt to dissuade Ravana. But again, it doesn't work out. Finally, Mandodari stands by her husband in the final battle like an obedient, faithful, a dutiful wife. And but yet again, she advises back again to her son not to fight with Rama. But still, it so happens. Several manuscripts of Ramayana have mentioned a story in which Angada drags Mandodari by her hair in the presence of Ravana as a punishment for Ravana's treatment of Sita. This section talks about the different kinds of humiliation. A faultless Mandodari, she had to go through different kinds of humiliation for the act of her husband Ravana. In one of the versions, when all the Ravana's sons and warriors die, Ravana organizes a yagna to assure his victory. And it is already said that Rama for this yagna sends Angada to disturb it. So Rama sends a troop of monkeys under the leadership of both Hanuman and Angada to disturb this yagna. And of course, we all know what is the nature of a monkey. It comes and disturbs the whole atmosphere. The same thing happened during the yagna. The monkeys create a havoc in the Ravana's palace, but Ravana is undisturbed. He's so focused that he keeps continuing the yagna. Now, all of them from the Rama side know that if the yagna is being successfully completed, then the war becomes even more complex for them to fight. So they wanted to disturb it. So for that, what was his weakness? His most favorite queen, Mandodari. Angada goes to the palace and drags Mandodari by her hair in front of Ravana. The pain, the agony, and the sufferings that what Mandodari is going, and also her decision that what her husband Ravana is doing is not correct, all compels her to plead to her husband to save her and remind him of what Rama is doing to his wife because of his act. The enraged Ravana, he becomes really angry when he sees Mandodari in that pathetic condition. He abandons the yagna. The moment he abandons the yagna, the purpose of the Rama's army, the Vanara army, is fulfilled. The enraged Ravana abandons the yagna and strikes Angada with his sword. With the yagna being disturbed, Angada's purpose is served and he leaves Mandodari and escapes. Mandodari again implores Ravana to surrender Sita to Rama, but he still refuses. In Krittivasa's Bengali Ramayana, the monkeys dragged Mandodari and tore her clothes off. This is the way she was humiliated. The humiliation met by Mandodari in the Bichitra Ramayana, it is said that Hanuman humiliates Mandodari. In the war, when Rama fails to kill Ravana with his ordinary arrows, he finally kills Ravana with a magical arrow.
Grateful thanks to Dr. Divya Keshamurthy ji for bringing such a beautiful insight about the character Mandodari. We'll meet tomorrow. Namaste.